Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Now each one of us sitting here are here with that process of thought and belief that we are the children of God, right? Yes. We're not sitting here for without a reason. We know we are born in the Spirit of God. We believe Jesus is our Savior, right? Yes. Now when we say we believe Jesus is our Savior, what do we understand when we say, when I say I believe my Lord is my Savior, Jesus is my Savior? I mean, I have faith in God. I know exactly what my God is for me. By faith, I mean, I'm accepting all His teachings, all His words, all His commandments that I have to follow, right? Now, let me give you an example. Now, a couple of weeks back, Mom started using the Kindle, okay? So, she has no idea how the Kindle works. Same way, she read a couple of pages and, you know, left it at that. She went to do her work. So, she asked me a question when she came back. She said, Mom, do you think, you know, the page is going to go back to page number one? Or am I going to start from where I left off? So I said, no Mom, it's going to start from where you left off. So she asked me a couple of times, do you think so? Are you sure it's going to come back? She asked me 2-3 times. So I was a little annoyed at that time. I said, Mom, it's going to come back from where you left off. That time when Mom asked me, I was thinking, we do the same thing with God many, many, many times. Lord says, you do this. We say, are you sure, Lord? When we take the counsel of God, we say, God, give us the counsel. He gives us the counsel. And then we kind of say, Lord, I think you should, you know, do it this way. Lord says, no, my child. Do it this way. They say, I said it to you. And you think things will work out the way. No, we don't stop there. No, Lord, I think you should do it this way. This would work better for me. I'm convenient this way. God says, my child, do it this way and see the miracle that comes out. Because I have told you. No, we humans don't stop at that. Problem with us is, we seeing is believing for us. We don't see God, that doesn't mean God doesn't exist. God very much exists, okay? That's what when something God says, you do this, my child, follow ditto, ditto line. When you do that and you follow, that's where your faith comes in picture. That's because you're not seeing what the outside and what the end result is, but still you followed what God said. And that's what faith is all about, right? When we ask a friend, we have a problem, suppose. You know, we ask a friend, okay, this is my problem, dude. Can you give me a solution? So the friend says, okay, my friend, as per my knowledge, this should be done and you will get your result. We follow, bingo. We say, okay, my friend said, why? Because we believe in that friend. Because we can see that guy, we can see that fellow's face and we say, okay, I know he's saying right. We forget that God gave us counsels. He has done so many miracles in our life. We are witnesses to those miracles of those times. You know, problem is we forget all that he's done and then we say, okay, we'll use our own wisdom, we'll trust man. You can't put your foot here, have the blessing here. You can't put your foot here, have the blessing here. You need to choose your place in the world or in God. You can't have two masters, right? Suppose God says you have done this, I don't think God will ever do wrong for you. One, he never does mistakes in his life. He knows exactly what he is doing, okay? Because he knows what he's seeing ahead. We as humans don't see what lies ahead, but God definitely knows what lies ahead, right? The Bible sometimes can be very tricky. The scripture says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, all these things shall be added unto you. Any wise man, we have, you know, even the holiest man says, Lord, I need to live, no? I need money, I need food, I need clothes, I need everything, I need a, you know, happy life. God says exactly what I'm saying. You seek me first and all these things shall be added unto you. Your smartphones, your lavas, your bursaries, cars, etc., etc. shall follow you. Problem is we don't put the conditions apply. Seek me first. Right? The problem is when we are not seeking God is because we have fear that tomorrow God does not give us, then what? If tomorrow I don't work and we don't have anything and God does not provide for me, what? We have two classic examples in the Bible. One centurion who believed that his servant could be healed just by the word of Jesus. He said, Lord, heal my servant. God said, done. He never asked, Lord, you did not come there. He said, he took the word of the Lord. Why? Simply because God said, he is the man of the greatest faith. By man of the greatest faith in Israel meant what? He believed, he obeyed God's word and took it for that. Man of great faith, he did not do a jig there. Or he did not offer sacrifices that God said, you know, you are a man of great faith. He simply obeyed God and said, yes, Lord, you said it is healed, it is done. Problem is, you know, we ask God, Lord, make me like you, make me an image of Christ, etc., etc. That doesn't happen overnight. You can't become Jesus overnight. Jesus became Jesus. Why? He paid the price of his life. He paid that price for you and for me. How? By obeying God's will, came on the earth as flesh and gave his price for us. Now, you know, you break a bone. Suppose you break a bone, you go to the doctor. Doctor says, cool man, I'll fix it for you, no worries. Doctor says, but I have to give you a little surgery and I'll probably give you a little anesthesia so you don't go through the pain. You don't go and tell the doctor, oh no doctor, you can't give me anesthesia, I want it done as it is. I'm going to be conscious and I'm going to get the surgery done. He says, no my friend, it doesn't work that way. You're going to feel that pain. Same way, when we ask God, you know, God, I want to be like you, I want to be just Christ like you. He says, okay my friend, I'm going to do it, amen to that. But I need to go through that procedure with you. And that anesthesia will have to be given. Now that anesthesia is the Holy Spirit, what God gives us. He helps us with the comforter when He's doing the chiseling, the molding, cutting off the sin from your life. That is where the Holy Spirit comes in picture. Because we want the process is, you know, we want the end result. We say, okay, the process is not needed, Lord. I want the shortcut. I just want the end result. It doesn't work that way, right? No, sometimes we see, you know, He allows the trials and temptations coming in our life. So, you know, we kind of say, okay, God, I am sitting like this. That guy is blessed more than me. He doesn't even do what I do. And, you know, I'm in a worse position than him probably. That's the time you remember the Lord loves all His children as one. Probably if He loves that person, He's going to give him the same blessing what you give. You want it. The only time, that time you have to remind yourself, I am the child of God too. I am the living God's, most highest God's child. And I exactly will get what that person gets, or probably better, but in His time. Problem is, we say, Lord, I want this, I want this, I want like this, I, you know, thing is, we never ask God, what God you want. God says only one thing, you put me first in your life, okay, put me first and do, trust me in everything that you do, then you see the miracle that happens. Fear is the biggest block that I would say the devil puts between you and God, because you don't believe what God says, and you're trying to contradict God's word by saying, okay, God, you said like this, but I don't think this is going to happen. That's where the devil comes in picture and says, yes man, you think you God is going to do this? No, you got to work for it and then God will give you. That's a very common saying in the world. Hard work pays everything. Hard work doesn't pay. God gives you what He has to give you. Whether you can pay, whether you do your bit is your bit. But God is there to give you that helping hand. So when we, you know, sometimes we do exactly the same. We say, Lord, I trust you, I submit everything. But when you're saying you trust God, means you obey what command He has given you, what following He is telling you to do, and exactly doing what He wants you to do, because that's where you're submitting your life in His will, in His hands. But the thing is, when problems come our way, you know, oh, we start throwing tantrums like 2-year-old kids. Why, Lord? Why me? Oh, look at the other person. He doesn't even go to church. He's so blessed, etc., etc., you know. But that's when God says, my friend, you are doubting my blessing because of your incapacity to think that I can bless you. That's when the devil says, we are in the world, we are going to have, there can be two kinds of blessings. One, you're in the Satan's hand, he's still going to bless you. There's no doubt in that. One, you're in God's hand, he's still going to bless you too. But that choice is yours, whether you're in the devil's hand or whether you're in God's hand. Now that blessing, you need to choose. The devil's going to keep, we are in this world, he's going to keep putting obstacles to, you know, break your faith in God, make you backslide, make you fear, fight with God, etc., etc. That time you need to say, okay Lord, I am in your will, I will do exactly what you say, probably not today, I will wait and, you know, trust your time. Whenever you feel lonely, you feel down, take the Bible, read it. It's an example of many examples that say, when God said this, I obeyed and the result was there. No, God said build an ark, brilliant example again. He didn't say, Lord, people will think a fool of me, people will say, what nonsense, are you building a 40 foot ark? He didn't say that. He exactly did what God said. He believed, he built the ark and the result was known to everybody. Same way in your life, don't try and use your logic with God. Let God do what He's doing. Probably it doesn't look good today. Probably it's not as happy as everybody else's. But in the end result, you'll be the one laughing last. For sure. Okay? So keep God in heart and all the best.
Thank you, Mansi. Mansi, excellent. I'm retiring. She does miracles. She prays, Devi and Mansi, doing wonders. You know, the Bible is gone in, soaked in, saturated Bible you could listen. You know, what is the beauty of this Elohim House of Salvation? We never write a message, we never prepare a message. And she's on the same footprint. You know, people shudder. When they hold the mic, they start trembling. The word doesn't come easy. But the Holy Spirit is a fluid. Amazing. 30 years, I never wrote a message. Great evangelical meetings, thousands of people in front. Because I don't know their heart, he knows their heart. All those thousands, what they want and what they have prayed, he knows. I can't prepare that. But when I stand there, he starts talking about them, who they are sitting there, convicting them. And then you say, "Ah, God spoke to me." Many people say, "God, you speak to me. God, you counsel me. God, you teach me." God said, "I didn't tell you last time. You didn't obey." Oh, I thought that was a man talking to me. Moses also was a man. Samuel also was a man. Jeremiah also was a man. Isaiah also was a man. And Jesus also came in a flesh as a man, but performed the mighty miracles. Amen. So today, as apostolic minister, standing here in a flesh, if I give a counsel, what would you think? Is it a pastor talking from his brain? Or he is talking through the Holy Spirit and giving you counsel?